Hello and welcome back to part 4 of Pulling the Perfect Key in DaVinci Resolve with me, Ben Brownlee from Boris FX. And this is where we left our hero in the last video. So we pulled a good key, we've got our hold in and hold out mats sorted out, and we've got our spill suppression sorted out as well. So all in all, this is looking pretty good. So the next thing to do is to start the actual work of compositing this against our background. The first thing I want to do is just try and get my background and my foreground plate a little bit more matched up. So at this stage, I probably want to turn on my scopes if I don't have them on already. And I've got them just down here. And the nice thing about our scopes is they are actually showing our composite rather than just showing whatever active clip that we're working on. So we can start to use these to make creative decisions as well. And at this point, I could add color correction just using the regular color wheels. But I do have some basic color correction tools directly within the Primatte Studio. So I can turn on color correction in the effect. And I have simple stuff that I might need, like temperature, so I can make the shot warmer or slightly cooler. I can change tint, so I can push this towards the magenta or a bit further towards the green. It's a little bit too far. And I have things like saturation, so I can push the saturation up or down and change brightness, contrast, and gamma. So maybe I touch the gamma up a little bit and touch the contrast up a little bit as well. I'm going to be very careful looking at the scopes here that I don't push the contrast too far and take this below zero on my parade. So I just want a tiny bit of contrast. Any big changes, I can make those with Resolve's normal color correction tools. Likewise, I can pop into the vector scope here and I go into the options and show this as the 2x zoom. And I can just check to see if things like my saturation here is well out of where I expect it to be. It's not really. We've got quite a cool desaturated look in the skin. I'm actually quite fine with that. Before and after. I've not made too many big changes here. Just getting things in sort of the right general direction. The next thing I can do now is start looking at what I'm doing with the background. And at this point, I'm going to turn my timeline back on and come into my background clip, which is V1. So with the background clip, I want to composite this in a slightly different way as well. So at the moment, everything is in focus, and that sort of feels a bit wrong. I kind of want to blur stuff out a little bit more. So let's open up my nodes. And as before, I don't really want to add an open effect to my first clip. I always keep that saved if I want to do any color correction to it at a later date. So I am going to come in up to nodes and add another serial node. And I've got my choice of blurs. So I could use Resolve's built-in blur. Probably the lens blur would look kind of nice. Probably not do it too much, be a bit more subtle about it. I want to have a little bit more control about where I apply this blur. So instead of using Resolve's lens blur, I'm going to have a little search here. Just type in lens at the top. I'm going to use the continuum fast lens blur and just apply that over the top instead. And that will replace the blur I already had on that node. So I definitely don't need the iris scale being that high. I can take that down a lot lower. I might even come into sizing and just see if flipping that is going to give me a more interesting result. Yeah, and I quite like that flipped. And something that's available with all the filters is the pixel chooser. And what the pixel chooser allows us to do is it allows us to decide where in the image we're going to apply our effect. And if I turn this on, I can now choose to come down to my mats here and create a selection based off alpha or a key or create a quick luma or channel key. Or I can come into the pixel chooser mask and choose one of the shapes that we have here. So something like a linear gradient. If I click on view matte mask, we can see where that gradient's going to be. If I change my rotation up, probably the other way, minus 90, I think. And change my distance. And change the gradient start as well. And the cool thing about the pixel chooser is that we still have the ability to interactively work with it in the viewer using the effects overlays. So if I turn off my view map mask, we can now see that we've got our gradient blur going on in the background. I'll just update the rotation a little bit here. Change the gradient distance. Actually, let's turn the map mask on. That's going to make it easier for everyone to see it. Yeah, change the gradient distance, and I can even zoom out using the middle mouse and just bring that over there. Alternatively, if I don't want to do just a simple gradient, because that's obviously something that we can do directly within the Resolve interface, I could use a double gradient, double edge gradient instead. And this gives me even more flexibility. And let's just turn the Open Effects overlay on, so I can choose where that line of blurring is going to be most prevalent. So something a little bit like that. And I'll turn the nodes off so we get a little bit more space for the viewer. And I'll come up and I'll make a few more adjustments to my lens blur. Add a slightly more interesting bokeh there. Touch up the type of blur a little bit. There we go. And maybe even bring up the highlights. And take the threshold down. Not too much. I want to sort of still keep a little bit of mystery to it. And make the last final tweaks, and let's just play that back, see what's going on. Cool, and that's starting to look like a slightly better composite. What I can even do at this stage, because we've got a little bit of focus shift here, if we look at the start, I'll zoom in a little bit, we've got our hero slightly out of focus at the start, and then he moves into focus. So I'm going to just quickly add keyframes to my iris scale. One where he's properly in focus and one at the beginning, and just kind of take that back a little bit. Just touch that down. Probably gone a little bit too far there. We actually don't need a lot to change it. We just want to make it look as if that rack focus is happening. And it's a small thing, but it makes quite a nice difference. Cool, so now we've got the primary color balance sorted. And we've added an effect to the background so that that's starting to match in a little bit more as well. What we're going to do in the next exercise is we're going to start to tie things together even more by creating effects behind our subject and in front of our subject. And it's at that point where we can start to look at the colors of the hair a little bit more and actually start to look at those small details that are going to make this composite look right. My name is Ben Brownlee from Boris FX. And I look forward to seeing you in part 5 of Pulling the Perfect Key in DaVinci Resolve. If you're enjoying it so far, please remember to hit the like button before you watch the next video. For the latest news and tutorials, remember to go to borisfx.com. If you want to follow along with this, use the download link in the description. And I'll see you again in another video shortly.